think we'll go ahead and get started. I'd like to welcome you guys to the first meeting this semester of Science for the People. Before we begin with Dick Levins' talk, I thought I'd begin with a little bit of the history of the group and what we're all about. So Science for the People is in its current incarnation is an attempt to revive a group that existed back in the 1970s and 80s, which emerged all over the country and the world, but especially here in Cambridge, out of the anti-war movement. So a lot of scientific researchers were doing science, and they were concerned about the war, and they had this observation that, you know, on the one hand, science is this great way of discovering accurate generalizations about the world, or more or less accurate generalizations, and it allows us to create all this great technology and stuff. On the other hand, it's being used to bomb the hell out of a small Southeast Asian country. And they realized that this wasn't really accidental, that this was something about the very sort of nature of the institution of science and how it was embedded in the larger society. So they started the group as a way to sort of explore this contradiction of at the heart of science, and to work towards resolving it. So they were involved in a lot of the big social movements of the era, including the labor movement, working with scientists and other people in third world countries, of course the anti-war movement, but they were also very concerned with criticizing and trying to change the institutions of science itself. So for instance, many of them were concerned with the use of science or pseudoscience to promote racist or sexist ideologies. Many of them were concerned with the hierarchical structure of science, the way it was sort of structured like a corporation with the big funding agencies on top, and the hierarchical structure of labs and so on. And also the way that the leadership of science was sort of deeply embedded in the institutions of the military and government and business, and how this affected the way scientific research was done. But of course, like as things do, this group sort of died out towards the end of the 80s. And yet this kind of contradiction that's at the heart of science, that Science for the People are trying to address, still exists. So in the past year, some of us have tried to revive the group. In particular, last year we held a reading group and a series of events, including a talk by Noam Chomsky and Subrata Ghoshroy right here. This year we're trying to do something similar with a seminar series and a series of reading groups, hopefully, which we'll talk about later in tonight's meeting. But first we'll be having Dick Levins give his talk.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, I'll start off with the proposition that all knowledge comes from experience, or from reflecting on that experience in the light of previous knowledge. This is true whether the knowledge gathering is institutionalized or not. We've had a very long history of science from ancient times. And what makes science different from other ways of acquiring experience is simply that we dedicate certain resources and people for the explicit purpose of finding out. So that you began to have institutions for science. But when you have institutions for science, the question arises, who owns it? And the first proposition here then is that science is always owned by somebody. Now, in throughout human history, these somebodies have been different. We've had pharaohs, priests of Mesopotamia, Confucian bureaucrats, English gentlemen of independent means who could meet at the Royal Society and discuss things that interested them. German science is very interesting because they made a deal with Bismarck. The deal that the German scientific community made was that they will have the freedom to explore what they want and express themselves, provided they don't rock the boat. And for a long time then, as a result of this agreement, German science was in the leadership of world science. But there was always scientific activity going on elsewhere. And we had scientific communities in East Asia, in the Middle East, and elsewhere. So in a way, science is polycentric, even though the current owners of science for the last 100 years or so have tried to control it. So the first proposition then is science is owned. Well, if you own something, what do you do with it? So the question came up, in what way do the owners of science manage science? What are they interested in? First of all, they determine who is allowed to participate in science. And this is a question of who is allowed to get an education. On a world scale, a very small proportion of the world's population is given access to higher education and therefore to science. So what this means then is that one of the great challenges to us at the present time is the mobilizing of the 10 billion brains on the earth. Science is carried out by only a very small proportion of the world's population, and everybody else is excluded in one way or another. So the first question was, who determines and who is allowed to participate in science? The next question is, what kind of science are they allowed to work on? What are the questions that are posed to science? And at various times, again, this has changed. Since Laplace was approached by Napoleon to see if he could design better gunpowder and other weapons, his answer was that he couldn't, because in order to be able to advance science, you need both the resources and the state of science. So there were resources, there were scientists, but the state of science, its structure of ideas and connections, collaborations, and so on, did not permit the inventions to order. So you can't simply send out a request through Amazon asking for something to be invented. And there always has to be prerequisites for the possibilities of scientific activity. Next question is, if you've decided what you're going to do research on, if the owners are deciding what to do research on, how are you going to do it? And here we have the problem that increasingly science is an investment. If it's an investment, it means that funds are allocated for the purpose of doing scientific work. And so the owners of science who can support science have to make decisions. What are they willing to invest in? One of the pioneers of American science was Benjamin Franklin. And Franklin founded the Naval Observatory with the argument that the prestige, prosperity, and power of a country depends on its scientific institutions. And so the United States had a certain amount of support for science all along the way. Okay, we've mentioned who's allowed to do science, and it'll come to mind of everybody here that there are some national groups who were excluded, that Black people weren't allowed an education in the United States, Native Americans, and so on, women. There was also the question of the poor. Well, the poor were excluded from doing science for the most part because they couldn't afford to. There are a few exceptions, like Davies, Faraday, who was in the laboratory of a well-endowed scientist and therefore was able to carry out his own independent research. Darwin, got a job on the Beatle, touring around the world, and the important breakthrough in evolution came as a result of that voyage, the voyage of the Beatle, where not only did he visit places that were not visited before, he discovered that there are plants and animals that are not mentioned in the Bible. He noticed that some of these seem to be very similar to each other in different places. And how might that come about? So Darwin came back and sat down to work on it and developed his notions of evolution and natural selection, with the one exception, that is, that he was afraid to deal with human origins. He thought it would get him into trouble. He knew the history of scientists being harassed back to the time of Giordano Bruno and Galileo. And so it was a very long time. There was the gap between his voyage of the Beetle and his writing in private, and his finally coming out and publishing Origin of the Species. And of course, as soon as he did that, all hell fell on him. The church was very much anti-evolution because they thought that they would be undermining religious convictions. The French were a little bit more liberal. And so the Royal Academy in France said that yes, they would allow Darwin to be a member of the Royal Academy because of his ingenious work on earthworms, provided you leave out questions of evolution. In the colonies, the struggle for evolution was very much connected with the political struggles for autonomy. So in the Spanish colonies, we had institutions like the Casa de España or Ateneo, and they would have meetings and intellectual discussions. And a study of the history of Cuban science reveals that in general, the people who are autonomous, wanting the independence of Cuba, were also the people who wanted the free publication of Darwin's ideas. The people who were most loyal to Spain were also loyal to the ideology of Europe and were opposed to Darwin. So the beliefs that people had about the bigger world infiltrated their beliefs also around scientific questions. And there were these struggles within the ruling circles of the colonies as to whether evolution was acceptable. Okay, now once you decide who's allowed to do science, what are the legitimate scientific questions, then you have to ask, what methods are legitimate? What's a legitimate question in science? Sometimes these would be questions which would be resolved later on, questions of astronomy, for instance. But there was the issue, what are the legitimate questions that scientists could work on? And very often, these were tied up with the expansion of early capitalist empire. So for instance, Newton's ballistics, Newton's gravitational work was tied up with the practicalities of ballistics in conquering mostly the Far East. People were going out on collecting expeditions. They were discovering animals that had not appeared in the Bible, and they wanted to know how we can use them. They were studying agronomy. And in general, in Latin America, the strength of science was in agronomy and medicine. A little bit of systematics as well, description. So we have a letter from the governor of Bermuda saying that there are little black insects here that the Spaniards call cucaracha, and they seem to get all over the place. Well, the absence of the occurrence of animals that you don't find in the Bible led to the question, how'd they get there? Was it just an oversight on the part of the editor of the Bible? Or Was there any significance to this? Well, Linnaeus was collecting from all over the world. Museums became popular. And a museum in the pre-Darwinian time meant a collection. So there'd be the great collectors who would build up museums in their own house, and they would invite guests for a drink and port and a dinner, and then show them through his collection. And the collection was interesting to the people of Europe of the upper class because it included things they'd never heard of before. So he began seeing evidence of extinct animals or footprints. And so in this phase, science was largely descriptive. They wanted to know what else is out there. Navigation. Astronomy was important for navigation and the study of currents. So there are a lot of issues of practical value for science. Often the science came after the application, however. So for instance, the steam engine is not a work of our best thermodynamicists. The steam engine was built by engineers, by master craftsmen, and once it was there, then the scientists started figuring it out, beginning to develop laws of thermodynamics. So you had these various elements of feeding into science that gave science its characteristics. Different parts of the world made use of different strategies because they had different materials available. One of the interesting things is the Chinese research on seismology. This consisted of a very large ceramic bowl with holes in it at different heights and then pebbles. And so what happens is that when there's an earthquake, the bowl would shake. Depending on the strength of the earthquake, pebbles would come out from these little holes. And that's the reason why we have Chinese data on earthquakes going way back. In other places, the emphasis was on the heavens for navigation and for agriculture. And so in those places, you have the development of the instruments of astronomic research. And we know about how it's easy to get into trouble doing that because, well, it challenged the church's view of fixed heavens. In modern times, science is a commodity. It is owned by the owners of other commodities in the country. And in particular, with the conquest of the developing countries in the Americas and Asia, science became the property of the ruling regimes. So for instance, the outstanding research in tropical medicine is carried out at the Pasteur Institute, the London School of Health and Hygiene, and Walter Reed Hospital. Because these were the places where you needed the knowledge to protect the troops. So we had a student here who did a study on the history of Malaysian medicine under the British. What she found was that in the first wave, the role of medicine was to protect the troops and the administrators. As a result of this, the mortality of English soldiers in Malaysia was quite low. When somebody got sick, they were sent home. And this was the case also in Guatemala, that plantation workers cutting bananas, if they got sick, and there were a lot of ways of getting sick there, would go to the local clinic sponsored by the United Fruit Company. But if that didn't work, again, they were sent home so that their deaths appeared in the mortality of their native province or village rather than as a result of the conditions on the plantation. Later on in Malaysia, they were running out of labor. And they began importing labor from China and from India particularly. And so the Malaysian medicine, the medical service, was then focusing on keeping the labor force alive. In the 1950s, there was a widespread insurrection in Malaya. And that's the point where the generals started cooking up the ideas of winning hearts and minds. And some of you may have heard of a physician, a Dr. Dooley.
Excuse me, we had a class here at 7 o'clock.
What was that?
We have a class here at 7 o'clock.
Oh.
In 253?
Yeah, 253. It's every week. I know it shouldn't be.
Reserve the room.
Teaching. This is in the classroom, right?
So is it possible to migrate or?
Well, yes, but.
I teach this class. I don't have a reservation. It's. Yeah, but I don't care about it.
Also, classes at 7.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, I misread the email. But there's a room down here we can move to. I apologize for this. Yeah.
Could be. I think there are bigger rooms available.
It's a guest.
Right, both directions.
Dick is up in the middle. Yes.
Yeah.
So we can gather our pizzas and
show them the room. Maybe there is a room then. Maybe they can kind of have to. That's what we're saying. Maybe.
Yeah. Okay.
Maybe they might not have to move.
Maybe they can move a Dick just in case.
He's fired. This is good.
Yeah, I apologize, but everyone would be okay with it. We move down to floor 270.
Okay.
Did they go terminal?
What?
Terminal.
No, I think it's okay for the chairs here. We'll clean up later.
We'll bring back the chairs that were dragged in.
That's a bigger room, right?
Yeah.
So all the chairs are enough there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we don't have to wait.
Somebody's jacket.
Remind me of
somebody forgetting their jacket.
Might as well take it.
It's next. Yeah. Somebody was sitting next to you. You remember who was sitting next to you?
Well, nobody shows up at 7:30.
We should record the entire
thing. Yeah.
If I switch off, I can't start
it. Oh, so it is recorded.
Oh. So this is, yeah, I should have told Professor Walker.
Oh, I don't know. Maybe this is not done.
Okay. All right. Let's go to this one.
I just got the forgot. Chris, what's the room number?
8205.
8205.
Which is, was told is down this way.
Can you grab me? I need to get it.
And they're much, much better. So it's like every once in a while, you take on a $38 billion position.
Congratulations.
I wonder, maybe during the discussion, I might ask you about Gerald Chan and his contribution to the school of public health. Did you have anything to say about that?
No.
Where are we going here?
Golden Gate.
Golden Gate.
We're going to win now.
Four.
MIT is next door.
But it's.
MIT is in you. Many a secret.
Not always. Nice to see the office. Sometimes for two. Where they are good?
Building 8. I think it's too far to be building right. Oh, okay. Okay.
Probably.
My,
yeah,
my computer's not working anymore.
Oh, it isn't. Oh, okay.
Sure.
Can you reach
for
the switchboard
down there? I can give you that. No, I
pick up discussing the significance of the fact that science is owned. The fact that science is owned means that the owners determine all the things I've listed before. Who's allowed to practice science? What are they allowed to practice it about? What are considered legitimate questions? What are considered appropriate means for solving problems? All of this is determined by the owners of science. And at various times in history, science was different, had different owners. Since in the Middle Ages, it was quite common for one of the tiny little kingdoms to have a court astronomer, a court clown, a court poet, and several other categories, which were mostly used to impress visitors from other tiny kingdoms. And it's for this reason that it was after the collapse of the caliphate in Cordoba, in Spain, then you had the tremendous flourishing of literature and science, because each little king, when the caliphate broke up, each little kingdom needed its full staff of cultural people to impress the neighbors. So science was there as luxury consumption. It's at a later time that it becomes a commodity. A commodity is something which is produced for the purpose of sale. Now, this has certain consequences. First of all, it means that the people who carry out the production at the bench or in the field don't determine what's produced. What they're doing is selling their time to an owner who then employs that time in ways that they find most convenient for profit and so on. Secondly, that it's the owners of production who decide how something is going to be produced. There are many different ways of making something. Some of them poison the workforce. Some of them are damaging to the environment, to the soil. But that's not the primary consideration. The consideration by most of the owners of science is what would be the most profitable way of doing something. So I remember a conversation with a research director from an oil company who was explaining to me that the agricultural chemicals division is only a small part of his oil company. So his first task is to convince the board of directors that making agricultural chemicals will be profitable. Once he does that, he then has to convince them that the particular agricultural chemicals that he wants to develop are worth developing. And in order to do that, he has to show that there'll be a market for it and that there'll be a technology which makes it feasible to produce. The market in agriculture, let's say in pesticides, would mean producing pesticides for the major crops, corn, soybeans, wheat, but nobody's going to invest in controlling the diseases of artichokes. There has to be a sufficient basis for profitability, and this gives rise to the unevenness of our knowledge. There are things we know about, and there are things that don't seem to be worth investing in. If something is a commodity, then the question is, how are you going to sell it? And there are various ways of selling. At the present time, marketing is a major part of the investment of product development. Enormous quantities go into sales. They want to be certain that something will actually be marketable, that they can sell it. And so they have these teams of people advertising. Very often in agriculture, the sales representatives of the companies are themselves farmers. So it's like the Avon sales lady. It's your neighbors. You don't want to offend them. So you walk out into the field. They'll pick up a bug. And they say, oh, this is an armyworm. You want to get. So pesticides become a major outlet for chemical companies. When that happens, the people who actually do the work don't have any choice in what chemicals are being produced or how. Now, I mentioned chemicals, but chemicals are not the only way of controlling pests. On my own farm during my farming days, we started out using pesticides, and we found that it smelled bad, and we weren't sure it was doing any good. We switched over to intercropping. Now, intercropping is a way of protecting crops by using mixtures of plants. So, for instance, whiteflies are a pest of beans. If you plant the beans together with other things, they won't stay there and feed. They'll come, they recognize a good plant by the smell of the leaves, by the texture of the leaves, by what it looks like. And so they come into a patch of tomatoes or cabbage, and they'll say, well, this smells like cabbage, and it looks like cabbage, and it feels like cabbage, but there are odors here that are not cabbage. And they leave. And so what we talk about in the trade is residence time. How long does a bug stay on a crop when it's part of a mixture of crops? So the cabbage with the tomatoes together will have less residence time than a field just of cabbage or just of tomato. Now, these agricultural methods, ecological methods of controlling pests or improving the soil are not as profitable. I mean, farmers would have to buy the pesticide every year, and that's where the profit comes. But you can't make a big profit by publishing a column on 100 hints for field and garden. So the decisions made about what science investigates is also determined by the owners of science. Very often this takes the form of tremendously oppressive management. And the history of the labor movement is a history of harmful conditions. We know the more recent cases like Bhopal or the Exxon Valdez. But the technology of modern industry makes things more dangerous in a very interesting way. The dials and indicators and protective devices on a modern tanker are so much superior to the protective devices of the old tankers. They used to have foghorns to avoid collision. Now they can use radar. The net result of this is that we can transport larger quantities of oil at once. The frequency of collisions is less, and the disaster caused by a collision is worse. So the captain of the Exxon Valdez was busy drinking at the time when they encountered the islands. And this is true for a very wide range of products. In a nuclear power plant, there's a large number of dials. And they have people whose task it is to examine these dials to indicate if anything might be going wrong. So the dial goes all the way up into the red. And the dial watcher thinks, who am I to shut down this enormous plant? Just because more likely it's the dial that's wrong. This gets into the press as human error. It's the human error responsible for airplane crashes, railroad collisions, et cetera. So the workforce is blamed. Well, not only do people choose the technologies, the owners choose the technologies that they're going to develop and the means for selling it, but also the intellectual tools for making the decisions about research. And this is one of the most interesting parts because it's pegged to the philosophy of science. Scientists in general are rather contemptuous of philosophy. That's just philosophy. Nonetheless, since the time of Bacon, science has been dominated by reductionist philosophy. Reductionist philosophy is the proposition that if you know the smallest bits of something, you understand it. Now, I have nothing against reduction. Reduction is the claim that if you look at the smallest pieces of something, it'll help you understand it. But it'll also tell you that you'll be making horrendous mistakes. Because we kill about 100,000 patients in American hospitals per year. There was a dramatic case in Denver in 1996 of a baby who was killed because of misdosing of penicillin. And the misdosing involved the concentration, the frequency, the mode of administering. And so Gordon Schiff did a study of the causes of this error and found that there were about 50 of them. There are 50 ways of doing things wrong in a hospital that could cause fatal consequences. Start looking more closely, and it's mostly a question of overwork for the physicians and for the nurses. So a doctor was careless in not specifying that this has to be subcutaneous, not IV. So we come into the domain of the errors of science. And we start out with the first proposition that science will always make errors. error is an inevitable part of science. Well, why? Look at it more closely, and you'll see that what scientists do is investigate the unknown by pretending it's like the known. I mean, that's the only thing we can do. You see a bug with six legs, and you say, ah, that's most likely an insect. You find a certain kind of fossil, you'd say maybe it's a human ancestor. So science is making errors because of this procedure of pretending it's like the known. But that's not the only way. While we've discovered many ways of making mistakes in science through hurry, contamination, misjudgment as to the behavior of a product. And so we've realized that we have to avoid error, that anybody can make mistakes, and idiosyncratic errors are a very common part of scientific activity. So we develop ways of preventing these errors. And that's what we call the scientific method. The scientific method would include a lot of devices and procedures. For instance, make sure that your petri dishes are clean. Make sure that the chemicals have not been contaminated, but are kept pure. If it requires refrigeration, keep it in the refrigerator. If you're doing experiments with mice, make sure they're all the same genotype. If you submit something for publication, get good peer reviewers. And so we have a whole listing now of elements of the scientific method that are selected and developed for the purpose of avoiding error. And more or less, when you're dealing with the idiosyncratic mistakes, if they're done honestly, it'll work. They're not always done honestly. We're seeing increasing frequencies of scientific fraud. And the reason for that is that the researchers figure, well, nobody's going to read this paper anyway. And like my grant comes up for renewal in July, and my professor's going to be really disappointed if his idea doesn't pan out. So there are increasing numbers of cases of scientific fraud from people in the laboratories. But aside from fraud, there are the honest mistakes that you try to correct with the scientific method. Well, in some things they work. They work when you're dealing with the individual era of individual researchers in individual laboratories. Where they don't work is when they represent the shared biases of a whole scientific community. Because then what happens is that the reductionist mistakes are common sense. Everybody knows that that's the way to do it. Everybody knows that you should heat your petri dish in an autoclave. And then something comes along like a prion, which is resistant to the ordinary autoclaving temperatures, and you may be getting caught with a minor epidemic. So we want to look a little more closely at the shared biases. One reason for shared bias is profitability. And so in the development of the slave trade, it was important for the Europeans to decide that the slaves were inferior. This was an intellectual scientific problem for them, but it was obvious. And even Jefferson didn't believe that Phyllis Wheatley's poetry was her own, because an African couldn't write that great poetry. So one way in which the shared bias of a community operates is by saying everybody knows. When the abolitionist movement was strengthening in the earlier part of the 19th century, that's when you started getting scientific racism. As soon as a bias is challenged, scientists are mobilized to say it's fine. And in this tradition of scientific racism, we have outstanding institutions such as Harvard, Louis Agassiz was anti-evolution. There were others. Asa Gray was for it. Different institutions had different styles where they would allow or not allow considerations of evolution or other such matters. So the scientific communities themselves provided the intellectual underpinnings for the biases in racism and such things. And it wasn't only in the United States, but Heinrich Himmler attempted to establish an institute for the scientific study of Jews. And he asked the SS to send specimens from Auschwitz. It was only after the expose of the Nazi atrocities that the eugenics and biological determinism went in, into disfavor in North America and Europe. There are other kinds of biases that are less obvious. For instance, the belief that if you find the smallest piece of something, you understand it. In Latin America, expeditions will go into the rainforest to pick plants to see which of them have medicinal properties. And if some of them seem to be useful in medicine, then they'll ask the question, what is the active ingredient? As soon as they ask for the active ingredient, they're getting into trouble. Because you ask the question, how come a plant has active ingredients? Well, in general, these are referred to as secondary compounds in plants. And the secondary compounds, well, in there have been evolved for protection of plants. There are different groups of plants that protect themselves in different ways. The cardiac glycosides are the elements of protection in milkweed, the tannins in oak trees, and so on. You can go through the list and discover the constellations of chemicals that are beneficial to plants in their defenses. So if you work on finding what is the active ingredient, what you're really doing is looking for an object that can be marketed. So philosophy of science is an important element in deciding on a scientific strategy, and conflict will arise between the owners of science who want simple profitable things and the people who would like science to be of benefit to humanity. And so an alternative approach to science has developed since the beginning of the 19th century, with Hegel, followed by Marx and Engels. And what they did was establish some guidelines which can help you deal with difficult and especially with complex scientific problems. First thing to do when you're dealing with a proposed solution to a problem is ask, well, and what else is there? What else is there is what's outside, because the truth is the whole. So Hegel said that when you've analyzed a problem, you've not solved it completely. Another question is, how does it relate to other objects of study? Now, this is something which is difficult for a lot of scientists who would like to reduce things to the simple, but they may ask the question, how is diabetes related to the rate of work in a factory? You get these connections that are less direct. What does the ability of a corn plant to pick up nitrogen have to do with the economic independence of women? I mean, there are questions which go beyond the subject matter of the first chapters of your textbook that ask you always to broaden the question, to ask how come. When you challenge special creation or the racist dismissal of different ethnic groups. The way to challenge them is always to ask, how else is it connected to things? It's a good working rule that everything is connected to other stuff. Not always very tightly, not always very closely, but in a way that demands that we look more broadly than the subject matter that's in the listing of the course. So we're facing now reductionism, ownership by somebody, selection of who's allowed to do research. So who are we? Under capitalism, though most of us are scientific laborers, the part-time employees, adjuncts, laboratory assistants, and so on, who are given a piece of a grant and told to come back next year with meaningful chi-square tests. And so the first thing about scientific workers is that they're workers. And being workers, they have the same properties. They are hired, that is, they sell their ability to work. They're told what to make. They do not control the distribution of their product. They do not determine how the product is made. And all of these things come together, the length of the work week, to produce commodity production under capitalism. So the first thing we know about scientists is that most of them are workers. The employer is a corporation, or a university, or a government agency, or a nonprofit. And they each work slightly differently. However, they're connected. And so here I'd like to introduce the Russian word nomenklatura. The nomenklatura was the Russian term for their civil service. It's the pool of people who could legitimately be hired. So these are the people who might be director of a factory, and then the editor of Pravda, and then on an advisory commission to the Supreme Soviet. The way we have a nomenklatura in the United States, the people who are senators, then move into the boards of directors of companies. These are the ones who say, I'd like to spend more time with my family. then they'll be advisors to the military. And you can track their trail, like the trail of a snail over a garden. You can track the trail of members of the nomenklatura, people who are in the State Department, candidates for office. We see it now in the debates about candidacies. So the owners of science form the nomenklatura, the rest of us form a kind of scientific proletariat, like the weavers of Lancashire in the previous century, who couldn't control their work, but were pissed off when they were being exploited. There is a difference, and the major difference is that as scientists, we also have a concern with the use of our product. So starting in 1967, there was the MIT research strike, where graduate students and postdocs declared that they're not going to help develop new methods for killing people. And it spread then from MIT to other places. So these are workers who also have a stake in the product of their work, which makes scientific labor somewhat different from other kinds of labor, from weaving or from mining. A second aspect of our existence as scientists is our thinking as activists. Now, in my own life, I've had the double existence of trying to bring to the political movements an interest and understanding of science so that you don't get simply a general condemnation of science. So in the political movements, my primarily of the left, my mission is to introduce science and make it a necessary part of people's thinking. In the scientific community, it's the opposite of bringing the message that what we do matters, and that therefore we have the obligation to think about what we're doing, to write about what we're doing, to find some ways of influencing what we're doing. For instance, joining in with the Bhopal survivors in demanding that chemical production be something which protects the workforce, and then you have to start analyzing how. From the point of view of the owners, it's good to have the workers living near the factory so they don't have to travel so far. But that makes them then more vulnerable to the disasters in the factory. And so you see the political battles in India around how to produce things where, what the housing would be like for the workforce, and so on. So that's two elements of being a scientist. A third element, looking at a world scale, is that many of us come from or are connected to other countries than the United States and Britain. And so we have concerns, what kind of science do we want for our own country? After the Second World War, the English scientist P.M.S. Blackett said, well, obviously, poor countries can't afford to do fundamental research. So what they should do is do research carrying out and applying the work that we're doing at the great intellectual centers. There were others who would be arguing that in order for a country to develop, it has to be both part of world science and had intellectual independence. This is important because there have been attempts to do just one of these, and they were disastrous. In Pakistan, there are movements for Islamic science. In the Soviet Union, Lysenko was pushing what he called proletarian science. In other places, there have been attempts to develop a unique science of their own, without fitting in to the patterns of world science. Well, the solution is neither one nor the other. That the world science has to be polycentric, have its own style of work, plug into world science, but also have its own journals. The overwhelming majority of scientific literature is in English and dominated by a few large companies like North Holland. So this excludes what is publishable and what's excluded, what they consider not good science. My colleague had an interesting experience trying to get an article on rabies published. For about 30 years, there were no cases of rabies in Israel. But a few years ago, 3 cases popped up. So clearly, the Ministry of Health went into a panic, and they decided to find out who's carrying rabies, and they picked out the jackals. So there was a campaign in Israel to eliminate the jackals, done in the good tradition of reductionist medicine. And in fact, their poison worked. They killed a lot of jackals. But as our warning tells us, what else is going on? Now, jackals are predators of foxes. So the removal of jackals created opportunities for foxes. Next, this was the period of the first intifada. During this time, the Israelis were refusing to hire Palestinians. So there was tremendous economic hardship in the Palestinian areas, in the Palestinian population. So what's an obvious solution? Raise chickens. Then there's the final step. Chickens are predilected fox food. So what happened then was that rabies resurged as a result of getting rid of the jackals. Okay, other places have had that problem. In Puerto Rico, the Department of Agriculture decided to introduce mongooses in order to control snakes. Trouble with mongoose is, first of all, it can't climb. So the rats went up into the trees, not the Norway rat, which lives in the ground, but the black rat, which is of Asian origin, climbed up into the trees. I would find when cutting bananas, you first have to make a racket and thump the bunch of bananas, and then you can come down and the rats run away. So wherever you get these schemes where single silver bullets will solve a problem, something goes wrong. In the struggle against dengue in Cuba, the problem is that the mosquitoes breed in water, particularly in small containers of standing water, like a beer can tossed out on the street. So, okay, the obvious solution is to get rid of the breeding sites for mosquitoes. And so a campaign is organized. Everybody gets all excited about getting rid of mosquitoes. Get rid of mosquitoes, so dengue goes down. So you call a press conference. We've eliminated dengue. People feel good about it. Say, okay, we've done that. Now we can turn our attention to malaria or some other vector. And the dengue comes back. The dengue mosquito, Aedes aegypti, is back. So one of the things we started thinking about is, in a model which includes mosquitoes, we also have to include the attitude of the population. So now we're working with equations where there are mosquitoes and the level of awareness in the community. And once you start working on that, if you raise the level of awareness to a high enough constant level, you can suppress the mosquitoes of dengue. Turns out that the Vietnamese are much better at doing this than the Cubans because of an incredible patience that you find in Vietnam. When I was in Vietnam, the Vietnamese were more in a hurry. The Cubans in Vietnam were more in a hurry to get their job done. While the Vietnamese were thinking, well, we defended ourselves against China for 3,000 years, and we fought off the French twice, and we liberated ourselves from the Japanese colonization. So now it's the Americans, but we'll get around to it. And so what I found in Vietnam was this enormous sense of patience, of looking at their experience and looking at things that were important, even if it wasn't obvious. Since part of my surprises there was that every air raid shelter had a bouquet of gladiola. Okay, now, I would like to close off by summarizing some of the major issues that I think is imperative for science students. First, to recognize that even in a profession, you're workers. And things that the labor movement has learned can be learned by scientists. The second is that you can have a stake in your own research, in the choices about how the research is organized, who's allowed to do it, what are considered legitimate problems, the choice of a research strategy for meeting a social need. And then finally, take the time out for looking at the philosophical issues that are behind your scientific work. That science is not anti-philosophical. Philosophy of science is stepping back to look at the whole, to take up Hegel's "the truth is the whole," thing, to see that things are connected, even if they don't seem to be connected, like physiology and psychology, environment and genotype. All of these pairs of opposites turn out to be very tightly linked, and some of the most exciting research comes when you start exploring those linkages. So that's pretty much a message that I would like to leave with you, that as scientists, we're also workers and activists. As activists, we have to be appreciators of science, and so on.
I think sort of a perennial tension between being a scientist and an activist is that as scientists, we want to be viewed by society, I think, as much as possible as objective. We want to, even if maybe it's never really possible to be so, we try as much as we can to objectively evaluate data sets and make conclusions from those, not based on what sort of we want to see in the data. But an activist is sort of a more inherently ideological thing. And I think you can be an activist advocating for ideas that are informed by objective science, but I think people, I think a lot of scientists are hesitant to do that because they feel that they risk losing their credibility as a scientist. So I'm curious about your thoughts about that.
Well, you're right, there's repression if you speak up too much. And so you have to make a decision as to what are the safe enclaves. My own experience has been that in any system, no matter how repressive it is, there's a boundary between what's allowed and what's not allowed. And part of the task of the activist is to push that boundary. I mean, this was true even in Nazi Germany, where writers would decide, what can they say that wouldn't bring the Gestapo to the door and yet help enliven people's understanding of the society? I have found in my own life that being a scientist and being an activist, rather than interfering, are mutually enriching. For one thing, some of my notions of the nature of complexity and process, my mathematical work, has come from participating in active political struggles, in the anti-war movement, but also in land reform struggles and so on. So the activism increases the complexity of my understanding of the world, but also my understanding of the world, the study of particulars, will enrich my activism. It may not seem obvious that way, but I did a lot of research with ants. And sometimes I would ask the question, what determines the numbers of ants on an island? And when I try to figure that out, I discover the numbers keep fluctuating. And that interested me in the general question of fluctuation. What causes the ups and downs of student activism? How come in the first few days after the shootings at Kent State and Jackson State, there was a tremendous upsurge of anger and protest on the campuses? 3 weeks later, it had gone. And there was nothing intervening in the meanwhile that would help me understand that. So I started looking at it from the point of view of the nature of dynamic systems. And what came to mind is that the behavior of student activism at that time was the interaction of rage and fear. Students were outraged at what was being done to them. But after a few days, that outrage would diminish and they were scared. Hey, I could get shocked too. And so these two processes, which have spikes at different heights and periodicities that were different, gave rise to the pattern that we were observing. So that means then that when I think about activism and campaigns, I also think about the question, what determines the dynamics of political activism, of protest, of feeling about this issue or that issue? What ideas are we most eager to change in the public by raising questions that are not normally raised, by asking the question, what else is there? What else is connected to the things that are on the official agenda of our own discipline? And when we start doing that, I think you'll find you're doing better science.
My question is kind of on the philosophical side. When you talk about complexity, do we run into the risk of making things eternally complex? This is connected, say, X is connected to Y, Y is connected to A, A is connected to B. So as a scientist, where should we stop and say that, hey, let's come to a solution? So what's the philosophical push-pull or the...
Well, among all the variables you might include, put in the same basket those that interact strongly on commensurate rates, so that the interaction is really mutual. If one variable is only an output of the system you're looking at, you don't have to worry about it. Same if it's only an input. But one way of deciding the boundaries is by asking, after you've done that, what else is there? What kind of mistakes might we be making if we don't take into account these other things, like estrogens? Postmenopausal estrogen treatment showed to be powerful in affecting heart disease. It also affects bone density and a whole list of other things. So we warn you, since we know that the biochemistry of an organism is a network of strongly interacting pathways, we will want to find out what other pathways are involved, let's say, in the neurotransmitters of the brain. Well, you find that most of them in your belly. It's that kind of philosophical skepticism, which always insists that there's more out there, that things are not really constant, that a thing is a snapshot of a process. And that means that when we're dealing with things, we have to ask, how did it get there? What keeps it there? When might it change? Will it be there forever? So that's a way of introducing general philosophical tools. Yeah.
Thanks, Dick. It's great to see you, and I always really enjoy hearing you reflecting on the things you're talking about. And I got a huge long list of thoughts that I've had. I'm going to try to narrow it to just a few snapshots and let you choose among them what you might like to respond to. I always, when I think about these topics, I always think of a scene from a movie directed by Fritz Lang, where there's a figure who's a scientist who says, a free science in the service of humanity. And then I think about that, and it's kind of contradictory, because if it's free, it doesn't have to be in the service of humanity, does it? So I just love that formulation, and I don't know, maybe
yes.
You want to comment on that, but shall I just mention just little phrases. Ownership. Is it really the ownership that you describe, that you seem to be describing? We have all these massive universities, so much research that seems, to a non-researcher, both corporate dominated, but also in many ways unrestricted, government sponsored, publicly financed. So is it, you give the impression of it being really tightly owned. Then there's another thought, which is about what's happened to Cambridge. This city we live in, many of us, which I now call Canta Biotechia. It's this massive biotech and commercial real estate explosion that's displaced many of the people who live here, had a huge impact. That's another thought. And then the last thought, you mentioned studying ants, and I didn't remember that about your work. And of course, I immediately thought of Ed Wilson, E.O. Wilson, the famous ant guy at Harvard, who I love. Just my meetings with him, he's a wonderful human being. And yet, he, for a period, was a target of some people who were aligned with Science for the People, I think, in a certain period. And to the end of his career, lecturing to the big lecture classes he taught at Harvard, would, at least during one lecture, show a real lingering resentment toward the ways he was treated by people who attacked him, claiming that his work in sociobiology was amounted to racism. So pick anything among all that.
Well, in relation to him, first of all, I'm always grateful to him for introducing me to ants. I was working with fruit flies before that. And we went out on collecting trips in the Florida Keys. Secondly, his ideas, Wilson is not a reactionary.
Right.
He's a liberal conservative. He's attempting to do honest work within the framework of his philosophy, but his philosophy itself is constrained. And we could argue with the substantive issues, but certainly not the kind of virulent attacks personally and physically against him. I think that it's an invitation to debate. And I don't remember the other things on your list.
Well, Cambridge biotech explosion in Cambridge, and the actual scope of ownership, the scope of
ownership. First of all, ownership has a history. What we call ownership meant different things in different societies. In some societies, ownership meant the right to hunt land. In other societies, the right to burn the forest. In other places, free safe conduct to pass through a region. So ownership itself is a concept which develops under capitalism. Even in feudal society, you didn't really have ownership because a lord might own the land of a serf, but it's owned by his lord, and so on up a hierarchy. So ownership is not a good scientific term. And, as far as Cambridge is concerned, there are these two separate problems, that of real estate and that of education. We see changes in the education system. Basically, what capitalism needs is a small number of highly trained experts, along with a vast number of docile producers. And so the changes in the education system, not only in the elite universities, but also in the mail order diplomas, the for-profit colleges, and so on, which means that eventually American intellectual life will be losing the capacity to challenge reality. It's too much tied up with the interests of the rulers. Friends, intellectual property is in a way a misnomer. It's not possible to turn thought into property because it's the product of several thousand years of cooperative labor by our species. And because they keep secrets from each other. They have to in order to be in competition. So a lot of companies have given up trying to produce new antibiotics. It's just not profitable enough. Does the world need more antibiotics?
I think it does. But it's not something that's a good investment at the present time. But 80% of the venture capital going into biotechnology fails to make a profit. And so Cuban biotechnologists like Agustin Laje are arguing that just as the factory system was the privileged form of organizing production and under capitalism, that intellectual property is something which is in the long run incompatible with capitalism and requires a socialist organization where things are produced because they're needed, where ideas are shared among institutes, then he deals with other issues of that type.
I guess
you have
time for one more short question.
My question is about your characterization of scientists as workers, which of course to some extent that holds true, but just in light of, say, activism in major universities since Vietnam, has shown that in many ways the universities are really tailing way behind the rest of the country. These are producing people who really are involved in social movements. During the Iraq War, there was one day at Harvard when news cameras went down to say, oh, students are out protesting the war, when in fact they were there celebrating their new housing assignments. So in some ways, what do you think about the idea that actually we have to spend more time getting out of our bubbles, whether we're one department or another, getting to know the rest of society, or is there actually, are you saying that there's a unique potential within the university because of the unique characteristics of scientists to come up with a leading force in the world?
I think that the scientists do have a special role because students are torn relatively free from their social roots and given a license to think. Then they'll be scolded if they think in the wrong directions, but there's still the license to think that can help you use concepts that come out of dynamic systems, since the notion of stability and instability. So these are things that are useful in developing a consciousness of activism. I don't think the scientists are going to lead the road to socialism, but I think that they can play a vital role in challenging the common sense of a community. In fact, one of the things that we have to deal with when advocating activism is to ask, what are the ideas that are most important for us to try to change now? That a mobilization is not judged by the number of people who turn out, or the number of copies of our party newspaper, or any of that. It's a question, what have we done to the thinking of the observers, the participants, and the cops? Because there have been times, like the Women's Pentagon action, where direct attempts were made to reach the soldiers who were guarding the Pentagon. And we know that there were the coffee shops, the GI coffee shops. So even in places that don't look as if they would be foci of progress, like today's Catholic Church. Students can play an important role bringing their own knowledge and special capacities to a larger movement, but they can't be that movement.
Before you thank and we thank Dick, I want to add one quick thing. You mentioned what happened in Kent State. I only just recently started a Facebook page after being at the anniversary commemoration of what happened there this past May, because people there said, if you want to stay in touch with all of us, better start a Facebook page. I've already posted a little clip of Dick's lecture, shared it with people, including one of the people who was wounded there, shot in the back while lying on the ground, Dean Kaler, the sister of Alison Krauss, who was one of the four students killed. So I just wanted to share that it's really, I was so happy to hear you mention that, and that they will be moved and appreciate your mentioning Kent State. Good short. Thank you.
Okay, thanks everyone for coming up, and thank you, Dick. I did want to note before everyone left that we are a group active here on campus, and if you're interested in helping out and organizing events like tonight's, well, first of all, make sure you've signed up on the sign-up sheet, and second of all, we will be having an organizing meeting in about 2 weeks. And make sure you come to it. Thanks again. Yes.
Yeah, is it Saul Witt? Is that his last name? Saul Witt, yeah.
Oh, yeah, this is